right, welcome back to the State and Local Sports Show with Mark Tennis, co-founder and editor of KaiSports.com. This week we're talking a little bit into the season basketball. Akira DaCosta of St. Mary's, one of the very select finalists for your Ms. Basketball State Player of the Year Award. How tough is it not just to get on that list, but to be one of the few who wins one of those? I mean, you're in a state with, 30 million people overall? I mean, that's not an easy honor.
More than 1,000 schools, 40 million people. No, it's really hard. This year we had a kind of a front runner most of the season with Sabrina Ionescu from Miramani in Orinda, and then in the state finals you had Gerliana Owens from Chaminade had a great game, and they had 30 points, 15 rebounds, et cetera. So did it get changed or not? And then Ionescu goes to the McDonald's All-American game as MVP. So
she set the score record.
Yeah. So, I mean, it that stuff can change. It's like a race where you have a leader, and then it can change all the way until the last very week, the last very game. And so it is very difficult. You know, St. Mary's has had three winners over the years with Jackie Jamelos, and Dominique Banks, and of course Gray, Chelsea Gray also was a Ms. Basketball. So we'll see what happens. But you know, obviously we have a pretty lead contender right now, and we'll be announcing that probably in about a week.
You guys have your All-State stuff coming up, both those awards and your All-State teams. The records, All-Area Girls Basketball team out Saturday, boys team on Sunday. You know, a lot of times it's a mystery for readers, basketball fans, players, coaches, kind of how these things are put together. I'll go into a bit of how we do our All-Area, but first, if you could you kind of take the audience through a few details of how you put it together, especially on such a grand scale when you certainly have not seen all of these players with your own eyes.
No, of course, you can't see them all. I don't see very many of them, actually. But first of all, we start off with a nominations list that we did actually from the year before. So you go from the year before and pare down the people who graduated, the people who came back, and kind of start with that as your basic framework is where you get started. So you have a big framework, and then as the season progresses, you have a more smaller framework of who's going to be in the top 10, the top 15, and that's of course based on who the top teams are, the top players on the top teams. Then the other part of the formula you look at very closely is what I call local consensus. So we will look at what you do, what you end up doing at the record, who your players of the year are. We'll check the Sacramento Bee, the All East Bay, the San Jose Mercury News, the All Southern Section teams, the San Diego teams, all those various honors around the state that there are, and there are many. And then you try to mix and match what seems to make the best fit when it's all said and done. Now, our All-State teams actually come out very late compared to a lot of others. And we do that for a couple reasons. One, it's hard to do the process. And then secondly, it keeps our audience engaged in the content for a little longer period of time, and that's real good for web traffic and all sorts of other reasons.
Absolutely. You know, for me and for us in general, kind of do sketches of maybe an MVP, maybe coach of the year throughout the year, first, second. This year we expanded to third teams. It was just a better year, I'd say, overall of depth for our area, so we expanded to a third team this year. And, you know, just kind of a little bit of a tease on the boys' side, we had a kind of things figured out award-wise, and it changed. You got
to wait till the end.
At the end of March. On the girls' side, there was so many solid coaching performances. We didn't solidify our coach of the year until earlier this week, made the phone call. So it's one of those things that's touch and go. You know, for me, there's enough teams in the area. Most of them I can see firsthand, but I call coaches to get their input. Not that that's the final say. There's like a vote tally, but just to get some input. And one thing that I think you'll see this week, and we stress, is that we really stress teams that win, players who are on teams that win. One, it's a good way to separate players who are pretty individually talented and pretty even. It's a good way to do it. And two, a lot of times winning shows the guys on the team are good soldiers as well as being talented. Not that there are plenty of great players, good guys who just aren't on winning teams, you know. But that's one way we try to do things. I think you'll see that this weekend a little bit. Looking over at high school softball, the Stampede Tournament, a really competitive Northern California tournament in Livermore. St. Mary's got a signature win, knocking off Archbishop Mitty. Yesterday, one of the top teams in the region, sophomore Carly Morphy throwing a complete game shutout there. They lost their other two games, but that's a huge victory for them. East Union still undefeated. I know they're number 8 in your state rankings. Am I correct about that?
They're number 11.
Number 11, okay.
Yeah,
that's my mistake. And they are hosting Oakdale on Tuesday, a huge Valley Oak League game. And certainly, I mean, if Oakdale were to get the upset, or if, you know, how could that game affect your guys' softball rankings?
It'd be pretty huge. I mean, East Union hasn't really played anybody yet. They were hoping they could play a good team in the NorCal Classic, and that didn't work out. San Benito ended up with an undefeated record coming out of that event, and was a team that moved up to 15th in the state this last week. So if Oakdale wins, that would certainly help their cause. It sort of depends on what other teams win or lose. This is a pretty crazy week, I think, in softball, because I know already we have the Michelle Carew Classic in Southern California, where Amador Valley went, and they're not in the Livermore Stampede. They're in the Michelle Carew Classic, and I know they won their first couple games. And Norco, which was number three in the state, already has lost in the Michelle Carew Classic. So there's a lot of movement. There'll be a lot of movement in next week's rankings in the girls, and there probably will be some still in the boys. And then after this weekend, a lot of the big tournaments in baseball and softball will be over with, so teams will be more in their leagues and the rankings will get more settled down.
You know, for Lincoln High softball, it's been just one loss wise. It's been rough the last couple of years, but once upon a time, they were a dynasty of a program. Your column, which he does weekly for us, already in the record, but is available on StocktonPreps.com and RecordNet.com. Could you tease to your column about what you talked about Lincoln softball in the past?
Well, I also wanted to compare Lincoln softball with St. Mary's girls basketball, because that's a dynasty everyone knows going on right now. Well, back in the day, Lincoln softball was number one in the state four times. I believe they were number two in the state twice, and in the top five two other times, in about a 12-year window. And back in those days, in the late 80s and early 90s, we didn't have like national rankings in softball. It didn't really exist. We kind of toyed around with an end of the season sort of Fab 50 for a while there, but there wasn't any national ranking. Now, if it was in today's world where Max Preps has a national ranking, I do a Fab 50 ranking for flowsports.com, I mean, the attention would have been great. And they would have been number one in the nation many, many of those times that they were number one in the state, because California in those days is even better nationally than it is now. So I wanted to kind of compare the two and then just highlight some of the players and teams that they had in those years. They had one team that was undefeated, another team that went 42-2, just some great teams and great players over a 12, 13-year period.
Now, it's not quite football season, but the Lions All-Star Football Game, which you help run and coordinate, is coming up in June. We have the North Team's Lions All-Star Banquet coming up on Saturday. Jody Sears, the head coach of Sacramento State Football, coming to speak at the Italian Athletic Club in Stockton. I mean, they've done an excellent job recruiting in Northern California, which makes sense for an FCS team. Tell me about the decision to bring him in to be the guest speaker for these young men.
Well, I think Coach Norton at Stagg, who is the North head coach this year, has some history with Coach Sears, and it seemed like a good fit. If you can get a college head coach, I think it's great to talk to young men that are going to be seniors. Now, I'm sure the coach would rather get some of the juniors and sophomores, because those are his recruits, but still, it's a great message, because every time you have kids who are just coming out of high school going to an all-star game, they still have dreams that they're going to play football for a long time. Some are going to go to junior college and then maybe go to Sac State in a year or two or something like that. So they're still very much in play. They still have their dreams. They haven't, you know, given up on playing at the highest level. And of course, we've had players from the Lions game go on to the NFL and weren't big-time recruits either, but they did go to the NFL. So that's the message I think we try to impart to the players. Make sure that they know they're going to have a great time at this game. The Lions game, what's great about it is the kids actually live on the same campus for a week. And that's the only All-Star game that I know of in California where they actually go to a camp like that. And they'll bond with these kids, their teammates, the North and the South, and they'll become lifelong friends. And that's really the best selling point for the game. And that's really what motivates the people on the committee to give that experience to those kids.
It's an amazing experience. And, you know, for the kids, you get to see these guys who not hated each other, but disliked each other from across the town, whether it be Manteca and Sierra, West Tracy, Lincoln, St. Mary's, and they're, that, you know, the friendship is forced and then forged by what they do. I think my lasting memory of last year is John Ward of Chavez coached the North team, and LJ Alofi Tule from Sierra is one of their linemen, and they were up in the game and they lost, and the big lineman came up to him, gave him a hug after the game, said, "Coach, I love you." I thought, wow, I mean, that's 1 week, but it's one intense week together, so I think that's what's so cool about it.
Definitely cool, yeah.
All right, Mark, well, thanks for joining us. As always, CalHighSports.com, the Gold Club membership, and a brand new CalHigh Sports website to show off.
Brand new website today. Yeah, we updated our homepage today. Lots of new pictures, new images on the side. Try to guess who the all-time greats are on the side. Send me an email, and you can win a gift card for $30.
There you go. And the Gold Club membership, less than $20 a year, less than $2 a month. Thanks again for joining us, Mark.
Thanks, Thomas. Thank you.